Somebody hold me too close. Somebody hurt me too deep. Somebody sit in my chair and ruin my sleep and make me aware.
Michael from Red Chair Diaries, Nova Scotia, Canada. I want to talk about this book, The Persian Boy, by Mary Renault. It follows a book called Fire from Heaven, which I haven't read, but this one I've had in my library for 36 years, I think. So it's about time I read it. Now, there are three, it's about Alexander the Great. And this one is told from the point of view of, I'll read the back. Bogoas, a young Persian eunuch of celebrated beauty, adrift from the court of King Darius, is taken as an attendant in Alexander's household. This story, as narrated by Bogoas, tells of Alexander's last 7 years as he pushed his conquests eastwards of the vicissitudes of his campaigns and of the love that flowered between the great conqueror and his Persian servant. A skilled and subtle storyteller, Mary Renault has written a powerful, richly detailed novel which proves a magnificent sequel to Fire from Heaven. And that's true. And a lot of these events made sense to me because they're in this movie, Alexander, which I really, really like. So I pictured Colin Farrell as Alexander when I read the book. And the Spanish dancer, I don't remember his name, as Bogoas, and Jared Leto as, I think, Hephaestus, something like that, who was the other man in Alexander's life. And very, very interesting. Now, I looked in this book here. Remember, I have a lot of reference books, and I bought this on the sale table 13 years ago when I was on a trip to Toronto. The Gay and Lesbian Literary Heritage, a Reader's Companion to the Writers and Their Works from Antiquity to the Present. So I don't think I've ever looked anything up, but I looked up Mary Renault, 1905 to 1983, and she was born Eileen Mary Challens in London, and blah, 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 and she wrote a lot of stories and so on. And she went to nursing school. Let me see. And wrote more mainstream novels, kind of like romantic nursing stories. But they all seem to have some kind of gay context or subtext. And the first ones were about like tomboy nurses and things like that. And then at one point she just started writing books about ancient Greece. And that's where she found her fame, and that seemed to be her métier, as they say. So it says here, Renault's first five novels have the trappings of nurse romances, but go beyond the norm of that formulaic genre in their shrewdness of observation and their submerged hints of lesbian relationships. And then I read another book of hers called A Charioteer, which came out in 1953, and that's actually about a male love affair taking place in World War II. So, let's see. When she was at Radcliffe Infirmary in Oxford, she met Julie Millard, a fellow nurse who became her lifelong companion. And then they moved to South Africa in 1960 after Mary Renault's fourth novel, Return to Night, won the MGM prize of $150,000. Now, that's a lot of money in 1960. So, and they stayed there until their deaths. So I think that's very, very interesting. So it says, not all of her major characters are homosexual, but their world accepts male-male ties without compunction. And it goes on and on and on. Blah, blah, blah. Above all, Renault's work depicts with love and care an age and a culture in which homosexual love was neither deviance nor norm, but part of experience. Anyway, it was just interesting to get that a technical discussion of her work. Now, the book really, really, really was interesting. It starts with a horrific event when the narrator, as a 12 or 14-year-old, his father's murdered, has his ears and nose cut off, according to the things that they did in those days, and then was killed during some kind of, you know, coup, regime change, whatever. He was a nobleman. And the Persian boy, Bogoaz, is taken away and basically sold, and eventually somebody else buys him and cuts him, turns him into a eunuch. And he's treated okay. He's ends up as the king's go-to boy or whatever. And through complications, you know, through historical change, through war and all of that, he ends up with Alexander the Great, who actually wasn't that much older than him. So it's a very, very interesting about the relationship, and you really get a feeling for how intelligent and how shrewd Alexander was, but he was so unlike a barbarian. He was so cultured and was good to, the only thing he couldn't take was treachery. He could, if you gave in, he usually just let you run your own kingdom. It wasn't the case that he wanted to have his hand in every pie. But it was if deception is what got him going. Anyway, this guy, that's supposed to be Alexander there. A detail of a statue of Alexander the Great from the 2nd century BC. But the point of view, this first person narrative from the Persian boy as to seeing all of this eastward campaign of Alexander's through Persia and goes all the way to India, and it's just is so interesting, you know, all of the things that that go on and how long he stays away from Macedon and Greece and so on. Macedonia, is that what they called it? But I just highly recommend this. It's not at all prurient. It's not dirty. It's I think it had the four-letter words. I don't think there's any in the book. There might have been. I think the worst was horseshit. I think that was it. Something like that. I mean, it's very, very literary, but very well written, and it just speeds along like that. You know, it's really, really nice. I really highly recommend it, and I'm so looking forward to getting what is essentially its prequel. It was published beforehand to learn about Alexander's earlier campaigns without this character in it. So I highly recommend this for anybody, heterosexuals, homosexuals, intersexuals, polysexuals, it doesn't matter. The book is very, very good. It's a good historical novel. With a lot of life, a lot of heart, a lot of love. Anyway, Michael from Rich Here Diaries, and I'll see you around the tube.